Check one, two, three. Check one, two, three. Check, check. One, two, three. Check. Check one, two, three. Check. Check one, two, three.
We're going to get rolling this morning. Thank you so much for being here.
His body bound and drenched in tears. They laid him down in Joseph's tomb, the entrance sealed by heavy stone. Messiah still and all.
Come. He's here with us. So come on and praise him, Lord. Come on and
good morning. We're so glad you're here today. Obviously, Pastor Bryan is not with us today, doing some baseballing this weekend with the family. So just got a couple announcements this morning. They're going to have to give me a slide so I know what I'm doing here. One second. Cool. All right. Project Homeless Connects coming up here on July the 8th. Wear your shirts. They're going to need a bunch of help for that. If you don't know what that is, get with Ruth Smith. She's the great the fearless leader of that group. There also is going to be a sign up sheet in the back of in the narthex. There, going to need muffins and cookies for that. They just need those by July the 3rd. So please sign up for that. I know they're going to need a lot of help there. They also need some backpacks, bike locks, and sunscreen hygiene items. There's a so the narthex. Straight back is the sign-up sheet for the other things to bring there. We'll be on a table right over here, kind of back that direction if you're seeing where I'm pointing. Also, youth mission trip. Commissioning service is coming up on July the 10th at 11 o'clock. Really would love for y'all to be there for that and be able to bless them and pray for them as they go forth to Oklahoma City, correct? Yes, okay. Cool. So, and then, of course, they leave for mission trip the very next week, and we'll dismiss them during Sunday school. Is that still right, Chan? Cool. So we'll do that. Love for y'all to be there for that. They always love to see everybody out there waving them off as the buses pull out. So also, still taking signups for men's retreat Labor Day weekend, which is September the 1st through the 5th. That signup sheet is also back that direction in the narthex. Please sign up for that. And then please don't forget the different ways that we have to give to the church. It is those gifts that keep ministry going at this church, and we're so thankful for those gifts. So thank you so much. Will you just pray with me real quick before we get going? Father God, thank you so much for this day. Thank you for this congregation. Thank you for constantly blessing us, God. God, continue to just use us and be with us in worship this morning. In Jesus' name, amen.
Good morning, good morning. As you can tell, Pastor Bryan's not here this morning, so you're stuck with me. We don't have any children in here, but so what we're going to do, last week we had Faith in Action Week. It was the first time we did this. And hopefully you were able to join in one of the components of it. We were here quite a bit of it, and it was really a touching week. We've put together a video of recap of last week. So, Jordan, if you'd play that for us, please.
Done great things.
you probably noticed that front portion of that video, everybody wearing the hairnets. And Monday night, our goal was to get how many? 10,000 meals prepped in this short period of time. If you weren't here, how many do you think we got? 1,000? 10,000 stinking meals in what, 2 hours, an hour and a half? Is amazing. Please bow your heads. Let's say a prayer of thanks for this past week. Heavenly Father, we thank you. We thank you for your presence this last week, Heavenly Father. We thank you for all the lives that we touched and will touch in the future with these meals, Heavenly Father. We thank you for being a part of this. We thank you for empowering the people that came in and endured the heat, that endured the time schedules and put things aside to come and be a part of this phenomenal week, Heavenly Father. We invite you here today, Heavenly Father. Fill this place with the Holy Spirit. May it touch our souls. May it touch our body and open our ears to hear the things that you have for us today, Heavenly Father. I thank you for your presence, not just today, but in our lives, Heavenly Father. And as we say the prayer that you taught us, our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. And forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, thine is the power, thine is the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Well, when I agreed to do this, Pastor Bryan gave me two directives. Number one, don't chew gum. Number two, don't go too long. I got the first one taken care of, so we'll see how I do on the second one. Today we're going to talk about inheritance. Okay? What do you think of when you think of inheritance? Grace, what do you think of when you think of inheritance? Family, Ken, what do you think of? Your inheritance. The definition of inheritance from the Google machine is something that is or may be inherited. Property, genetic qualities, the acquisition of possession, condition, or trait from past generations. A valuable possession. I posed this question to the college group a couple of weeks ago. I think it was about a month ago. And they had the standard answers, right? Money, that was number one. Somebody said car, Corvette. I'm like, I'm on board with you. Property, but then someone said traits, you know, the color of my eyes, my hair, my genetics, I inherit. Yeah, I didn't think about that. And then one of them, I think it was Ethan, said my faith. That's true. I thought about it. My mom and dad took me to church on a daily basis. I mean, what a great inheritance that I got from them. If we boil it down, it's something of worth. Something of beauty. Pastor Bryan's last sermon series on Galatians about a month ago, we talked a lot about our inheritance, right? We talked a lot about what is made available to us. That moment we accept him. It was really a good series. I enjoyed it a lot. Today I'm going to look at Ephesians. This is one of Paul's prison prayers that he writes to the church of Ephesus while he's in prison. And I think it's important for us to note that in all of Paul's prison prayers, in Ephesians and Philippians and Colossians, all of his prayers that he wrote while in prison, in none of these prayers does he ask for any material things. His emphasis is on the spiritual perception and the Christian character. He doesn't ask God to give them things that they already do have. He's not asking God to give them what they don't have, but he prays that God reveals to them what they already do have. Ephesians 1, 18 through 19. I pray also that the eyes of your heart may be enlightened in order that you may know the hope to which he has called you, the riches of his glorious inheritance in the saints, and his incomparably great power for us who believe. In this prayer, we see Paul is asking for specifically three things: enlightenment, knowledge, and power. Paul continuously prayed that we would lean on this power and the beauty that is made available to us through the Holy Spirit. Let me give you a quick analogy. In the early 1900s, Chief Crowfoot was the chief of the Blackfoot Nation in South Alberta, Canada. Well, the Canadian Pacific Railway was planning on laying some tracks from Medicine Hat all the way to Calgary. The most direct path for this stretch of track was right through the middle of the Blackfoot Nation. So the railway decided to make a deal with Chief Crowfoot, right? They made a pact with him, and the pact was, Chief Crowfoot, you're going to get a lifetime pass on the Canadian Pacific Railway. You can go wherever you want, whenever you want, no charge. Chief Crowfoot was so proud of this deal, he took that pact, created him a little leather pouch, stuffed that pact in his pouch, and wore it around his neck the rest of his life. At the end of Chief Crowfoot's life, he still had that pact on, but he had never stepped foot on any train, took one ride on that railway. Paul continues to impress us not to be like Chief Crowfoot. We've been given this beautiful, beautiful gift. He doesn't want us just to walk around with it on our neck and never use it. Paul starts this prayer with, I pray also that the eyes of your heart may be enlightened. The eyes of your heart? What's he talking about? I didn't learn about any eyes in my heart in biology. Physical eyes and ears cannot hear or see these deeper truths that Paul is trying to impress upon us. They must be revealed to us. Like John MacArthur says, they are revealed only to those who love him. The eyes are our organ of vision, right? That's how we see. But Paul goes figurative here. It's really a beautiful picture that he's painting. The heart, having eyes to see, to look towards God, and all the spiritual blessings that he had, that have the source and supply in Jesus. Proper understanding of the spiritual truth is not dependent on a keen intellect, but rather on a tender heart. And the heart is what? The center of our being, right? Pumps our blood. Especially in Paul's time, they viewed the heart as the keeper of the soul. I mean, that was everything. And Paul wanted us to have this deep cardiac moment. Paul knew we needed this enlightenment. And this enlightenment is clearly the work of the Holy Spirit that leads us to that belief, that intuitive understanding of what is available to us through Christ. See, when I heard this scripture for the first time, that's what happened to me. I was enlightened by these words. It blew me away. I heard this for the first time, one of my good pastor friends in a Kairos team meeting. He got up and preached on this. Blew me away. That's what happened. I was enlightened by these words. My heart heard these words. And they began to help me see things differently, more beautifully. Mal Couch writes, while this is Paul's great desire, that the eyes of our heart be enlightened, that believers truly have a deep spiritual understanding about their relationship with the Lord. This is rarely achieved by the average Christian. The world gets in the way, sin does its dirty deed, and carnality and strife and bitterness can rule. But what a high and lofty idea the apostle sets for us. He wishes this knowledge of God would impact the minds and hearts of every child of God. And isn't this what happens so often? We have one of these mountaintop experiences, right? Maybe it's something Pastor Bryan said here on a Sunday morning. Maybe it's working this last week. Maybe something touched you that last week. Maybe it's a retreat or a Kairos or something. But we have this mountaintop experience, right? And as soon as we get back into the real world, bam, it hits us, right? Knocks us back down. It's almost like you're saying, you know, We don't have any room for that here. Not him, the other him. Paul wants us to be enlightened by the Holy Spirit, the only one capable of truly letting us understand what we need to know. And that gets us to the know part of this prayer. And this is the beautiful part. In order that you may know the hope to which he has called you, the riches of his glorious inheritance in the saints. I'm going to repeat that. In order that you, me, all of us, may know, what does he want us to know? The hope to which he has called you. What has he called us? He has called you the riches of his glorious inheritance in the saints. Whoa. I heard that and it knocked me down. What? Are you kidding me? I mean, we learned in Galatians, we inherit from him, not to him, right? I'm a saint, you're a saint, we're all saints. This is telling me that I'm his inheritance. That's what Paul is telling me. And you know what this really says to me? This tells me that God is sitting up there, he's looking down, at me. He's saying, man, look at Danny. I love him so much. I can't wait for him to be here with me. He's so wonderful. Gosh, I love him so much. And he's saying that about you. And you. And all of us. See, he loves you. He loves me. He desires to be with us. See, that special moment, that special, special moment when we finally decide to answer that knock at our heart, answer the door to the heart of to our heart, that moment that we reach down to the doorknob, to that door in our heart, that moment that Paul talks about in Colossians 1:27, to them God has chosen to make known among the Gentiles the glorious riches of this mystery, which is Christ in you, the hope and glory. That moment that you crack that door, just a very little bit, that special moment where heaven meets earth, and you crack that door and the Holy Spirit just rushes in like a wild fire and consumes you, every inch of you. And we gain this counselor that Jesus talks about in the upper room in John 14:26. But the counselor, the Holy Spirit, whom the Father will send in my name, will teach you all things and will remind you of everything I've said to you. That spirit that rushes in when we open that door, that's when we are Christ in us. That's when we are one. That's when we get this power that Paul is talking about at the end of this verse, the same power that he talks about in Romans 8:11. And if the spirit of him who raised Jesus from the dead is living in you, he who raised Christ from the dead will also give life to your mortal bodies through his spirit who lives in you. The same power that rose Jesus from the dead is now in you, in me. Man, some of this is just too much. Some of it's just too magnificent for me to comprehend. John MacArthur makes an excellent biblically logical point. He says, until we comprehend who we truly are in Jesus Christ, it is impossible to live an obedient and fulfilling life. Only when we know who we really are can we live like who we are. Only when we come to understand how our lives are anchored in eternity can we have the right perspective and motivation for living in time. Only when we come to understand our heavenly citizenship can we live obedient and productive lives as godly citizens on earth It is truth too magnificent for words to describe, which is why even God's own revelation requires the illumination of His Spirit in order for believers even to begin to understand the marvelous magnitude of the blessings of salvation that exist in the sphere of the saints. See, church, there's nothing more to seek. There's nothing more to be given. There's nothing more to be received. I mean, we have it all right now, and we'll have it throughout eternity. Wednesday night of last week, we had the opportunity to go serve at Talitha Kum. If you don't know anything about Talitha Kum, I highly recommend you check them out. They're doing beautiful things in our community. And when we got there, you probably saw the men's portion of the group, me, Justin, Pastor Bryan, and Matt. You probably saw one of the last slides. We were putting together a bus, right? That was our job, a little playground bus. Well, the only problem was when we went to the backyard, this bus was in multiple pieces scattered around a yard. So first thing we had to do was get that over there, and we started putting it together. And Susan, the director over there, gave me a bag of hardware to use to put it together. Well, comes to find out only a quarter of that hardware actually fit. It wasn't the actual hardware. Somebody decided to buy some, and of course, that never works out. So we figured, let's get as far as we can go, and, you know, I'll make a list. My plan was, we'll go as far as we can go. I'll make a list for Susan and what tools and what she needs to buy to get it put together, and, you know, we'll go on our way. We did our job, right? Well, I go and get her after we got as far as we could go. And as she walked out with us, she had some water, and I could kind of see her face drop a little bit, and I didn't recognize it. And well, come to find out, we got this playground put together, but it's not safe for kids to play on. But there's going to be kids there tomorrow, so we have to try to figure out a way to get it playable. So we did what every man does when he doesn't have the right tools. Me and Pastor Bryan grabbed some duct tape, and we ducked it together. But as I was sitting there duct taping, me and Pastor Bryan were doing it, and Matt was talking with Susan, and I heard him kind of going back, you know, how can you get this done and everything, and she mentioned that she had two maintenance guys, but they barely know how to clean, and I'm sitting there doing my job, and I got my plan right. But in that moment, I wasn't listening to the words that she was saying. God made me hear something else. I'm sitting there sweating because it was not cool. Just trying to get my job done. And what I heard her say, I don't have anybody to put this together. I don't have anybody. And God told me right there, you're going to go out next week and you're going to finish putting this together. So after we got it ducked, I told Susan, said, Susan, I'm going to go buy all the hardware. I'll get this put back together. And you could just see her face lighten up. It's nothing that we did, right? It's nothing. I mean, that we haven't even put it back together yet. We're going tomorrow night. But it's listening to God. And I was on the way home from that in my truck by myself. And I started talking with God and just thanking Him for the opportunity to be able to serve. And you know what He told me? He told me, this is what you're created for. And I was so taken aback. You can ask Ken Flowers. As soon as I got done with this prayer, I hadn't dialed Ken's number in about a year, year and a half, and he was the first person I called when I got done. And after our conversation, it was meant for me to have called him. But he said, this is what you're created for. You're not created to be a Cisco salesperson. You're created to do my work. You're created to be with me. Paul wanted us to know this hope, this inheritance, and this power, not in our heads, but in our hearts, the very essence of our being. When we know them in our heads only, we're just smarter sinners. When we know them in our hearts, we're working to become more Christ-like, moving towards Him. How wonderful to know that each moment of the day, God's working on us in this way. And it's this promise that blew my mind away that day. So as we leave here today, don't be like Chief Crowfoot. Don't wear this beautiful, beautiful gift around your neck and never use it. Are you praying these prayers, these promises over yourselves, over your families? Don't miss out on this special opportunity. And as I go into prayer, I'll welcome the band back up and we'll finish out. Heavenly Father, we thank you for being here today. Help us, Heavenly Father, to gain understanding of these truths and your promises, Heavenly Father. Help us to grasp them, Heavenly Father, and help them to us to use these in our daily lives. In Jesus' name, amen. Please stand and worship with us.
Yeah. So my life, you
Hear your benediction. Father God, we thank you so much, God, for today. We thank you for giving us an opportunity to come and worship you as we go forth. In the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, amen.